a typical summer barbecue near what some see as hallowed ground. It was here 5 years ago that Officer Darren Wilson shot and killed 18-year-old Michael Brown.
To me, that just little patch just reminds me of exactly where it happened at. I can't drive over it. I don't know what that is. I don't know how to explain it or why, but I can't. I'll drive around it.
Fran Griffin helped organize this event as part of the Southeast Ferguson Community Association. The group was formed in the wake of Brown's death to provide community services. Like many others, Griffin was spurred to protest after Brown was killed. And earlier this year, she won a seat on Ferguson City Council, becoming the first Black woman to represent her ward.
When Michael Brown Jr. was killed, it changed the lives of so many people, not just here in Ferguson, but throughout the entire world. It changed my life. I never, ever would have thought that I would have been a politician, but I found something that I could do that would help my community.
Brown's death thrust Ferguson, a city of 22,000, into the national spotlight. Images of police and armored vehicles firing tear gas at protesters and demonstrators setting fire to businesses fueled intense debate. Now, as another anniversary approaches, many are taking stock of what has changed.
We have a lot of new staff members around City Hall. We have a lot of new staff people, especially in the police department. We have a lot of new council members.
James Knowles is mayor of Ferguson. He is one of the few remaining city officials from 2014. He remains the target of intense criticism, but insists the city has made meaningful strides.
We have a tremendous amount of new officers in our police department, a much more diverse police department than we had in the past. Our courts are much more focused on working with people to not get caught in that kind of cycle of being in the court system through traffic tickets or housing fines.
Of course, many of those reforms were mandated by a Justice Department consent decree. In 2015, the DOJ concluded law enforcement practices in Ferguson were, quote, shaped by the city's focus on revenue rather than public safety needs. It also determined that African Americans were arrested at disproportionate rates and some without probable cause. Statewide, Black drivers are still nearly twice as likely as others to be stopped. In Ferguson, the disparity in traffic stops of Black drivers has also increased by 5% since 2013. Yet Ferguson has reduced its ticketing. In 2014, the city issued nearly 12,000 tickets. Most were for minor municipal code violations. In 2017, that number was just under 2,000. Now revenue has fallen from nearly $2 million in 2014 to just under $400,000 in 2017. The municipal court has also vacated nearly 10,000 arrest warrants. There have also been broader changes.
We know this issue isn't limited to the borders of Ferguson.
Last year, Wesley Bell was elected St. Louis County Prosecutor. The former Ferguson City Councilman defeated Bob McCullough, who declined to indict Officer Wilson.
It was more of the typical incarcerate your way out of every problem. Someone is struggling to pay child support, put them on probation or lock them up. Someone has a drug issue, put them on probation or lock them up, and that exacerbates the problem. Any of you who've worked the street know you're seeing the same people over and over who just need treatment.
Instead, he is prioritizing pre-trial diversion programs, cash bail reform, and decriminalizing low-level drug charges.
We want to make sure that people who are incarcerated need to be incarcerated, and those that do not need to be should not see the inside of a jail.
Since Bell has been in office, St. Louis County's jail population has dropped by 16%.
There are still serious questions over just how much change has come to Ferguson. Storefronts like these remain shuttered, and development is slow. And there are still stark racial divisions and deep tensions between the community and the police.
Councilwoman Griffin worries the third ward, which has the highest percentage of Black residents and the lowest income levels, is not getting enough resources.
In terms of just the little small mom and pop stores, like those aren't existing. You've got a few beauty supply houses, you've got a few beauty salons and nail shops, but in terms of actually providing resources to people where they can, in walking distance, where they can go and shop, I would say no.
Last week, a Missouri nonprofit announced plans for a new development project. It will include a health center and possibly a grocery store. Still, some in the city remain deeply worried about interactions with the police and racial profiling.
If anything, it feels the same, you know? I don't feel like nothing different. I don't feel like it has enhanced or anything like that. I don't even feel like I can call the police to save myself.
Marcus Hicks and Travis Bowl, both 22, live in Ferguson and saw the protests here in 2014.
Like, being a black male, it's just, like, I feel like it's just like it's never gonna change. Like, they gonna forever think we on some type of BS or some type of gangbang and stuff like that.
Yet some wrongly believe black residents deserve extra scrutiny.
If you watch how some of these people drive, you know what. You know what color they are. I'm not prejudiced, but we can tell by the way they drive.
Judy McCarty has lived in Ferguson since she was 2 and lives just blocks from where Brown was killed. And while her husband, William, says some court reforms were needed.
When you come in to pay a ticket and you've got 4 other outstanding warrants and they put you in jail, you can't pay your fine if you're in jail. You're not gonna be working.
Still, they worry things have gone too far.
Let's not go the opposite way, where the way they seem to be going now is, and there's no punishment for abusing the law.
Right.
At the same time, Ferguson's independent monitor testified the city needs to do more to actually implement policy changes, including new police training. But Mayor Knowles says the costs are too high, which has rankled many activists.
There is no police department in Missouri, very few in this country, that do all of the things that are required by our consent decree. We have to go through more hoops. We have to endure more training, more scrutiny.
To them, the mindset is it's not fair that we're being penalized because of what happened here, because everybody else was doing it. That's the wrong mindset to have.
Griffin says it's that kind of sentiment that makes her concerned the city may revert to its old practices. But she's also confident in the momentum of the last 5 years.
Whenever I pass up the space, like, it's a constant reminder of the what my responsibilities are. It's a constant reminder of the pain that an entire community felt. And it's just a constant reminder that we got to keep fighting.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Yamiche Alcindor in Ferguson, Missouri.